The government has reached a $500 million cost-sharing deal with councils in Hawke's Bay to buy out uninhabitable homes and invest in climate-resilient infrastructure. The region is the first to reach a cost-sharing deal. It'll help to rebuild transport infrastructure as well as provide $70 million in flood protection for Wairoa. But there are still hundreds of homes across Hawke's Bay, Tairāwhiti and Auckland with Category 3 status, meaning owners will be offered a buyout option. I sat down with Cyclone Recovery Minister Grant Robertson and began by asking him how much individual Hawke's Bay homeowners will receive.
That's the subject for negotiation between the local council, because they are in charge of the buyout program, and the homeowner. Clearly it's going to be based on a valuation before all of this happened, but the detail of that is in the hands of the local authorities. We set ourselves up here to do a locally led recovery centrally supported. Our central support's on the table now in terms of Hawke's Bay, but that detail is between local authorities and homeowners.
From what you understand, though, is it likely to be a council valuation?
Well, that is up to them, and I'm not going to preempt that, but it certainly will be a valuation, obviously, before the event. The exact way that they do that will be down to those local authorities.
Would you expect that homeowners would have an opportunity to contest those valuations?
There's clearly going to need to be a process for people to work through, and that's what the councils will now be working on. What the indication I've had is that they should, within about a month, be in a position to be making offers to people.
Will the Tairāwhiti and Auckland councils accept the 50-50 cost sharing for the buyout of Category 3 homes?
We've good discussions taking place with both Tairāwhiti and Auckland, and we're making progress there. That's clearly the basis that we're moving forward on in terms of cost sharing. We said at the outset that the government could not pay for everything here. We've obviously want to support people who've been affected in these areas, but we've also got wider obligations to the rest of the country. We think it's a fair position, particularly when you sit it alongside the other support that we're doing, the flood protection work, the transport work that we've agreed with Hawke's Bay. So that's the basis on which we're going into those discussions with Tairāwhiti and Auckland, and they're going well, but they've got a little bit more to go.
I appreciate that there's infrastructure and resilience spending that you are contributing to in a big way, but when it comes to the actual cost sharing for houses and the buyouts of those Category 3 houses, are you considering the respective councils' differing financial positions in those negotiations?
The way we've tried to approach this is to have a principled basis that can be applied across the country, but then have conversations with those councils about the financing arrangements that they might need. It'll be absolutely obvious to everybody that Tairāwhiti District Council is in quite a different financial position to Auckland, and so we have to work with Tairāwhiti around how we can support them to have the kind of recovery and rebuild that they want. So to me, there's two stages in many ways in this conversation. There's an argument or a discussion or a negotiation about funding, and then there is a discussion potentially about financing, about the way that we might be able to support a council, especially one like the Gisborne District Council, who are a small unitary authority. Mm. So we're trying to apply a principle basis to the negotiation, but clearly there are different circumstances that have to be dealt with in each area.
I mean, arguably, Auckland Council is not exactly awash with cash at the moment either.
Strong asset base,
yes.
A large ratepayer base.
But how many houses need to be bought out?
Yeah, well, this is the thing, and at the moment that's still a piece of work that Auckland's doing. And look, I don't want to belittle what Auckland has to face here and what the homeowners in Auckland are going through. And as I say, we're trying to apply a principled basis to the cost-sharing arrangement.
So how many nationwide do you expect to
The numbers are moving around as more work is done on the categorisation. We've got about 260 in the Category 3 category in Hawke's Bay, probably between 40 and 50 in Tairāwhiti that we're just working through now. Auckland, that work is still ongoing. It'll be in the hundreds, obviously, because we know about some of those communities, but we haven't been able to quite get to that figure while Auckland Council goes through their work.
I know how tricky it is getting to a point of certainty, but you have hundreds of homeowners, thousands of New Zealanders who are in a state of flux at the moment, who are just treading water, waiting to know how they're going to go ahead with their lives. When will we have certainty in Tairāwhiti, Auckland and Hawke's Bay for all of those affected homeowners?
Well, obviously for Hawke's Bay, we've done the deal now with the councils. As I say, my expectation that I've been given is within about a month that there'll be offers there for the buyouts there. Tairāwhiti, I think we're pretty close. That won't be far away and should end up on a similar time scale. Auckland, the scale's bigger. There's also us needing to work through their Making Space for Water program that they've got, which is an existing program around where they're going to have future development. So I'd like to think we can get that resolved, obviously, in the next month or so, because we've got a certain event in October and it would be good to get it all done before then.
Let's talk holes.
ACT and New Zealand First both claim you're facing a massive revenue shortfall, $20 billion and $30 billion respectively. The Crown revenue to the end of May was more than $2 billion lower than previously forecast because of corporate tax intake. Do you have a revenue shortfall that exceeds your most recent publicly available forecasts?
Well, the most recent publicly available forecast is the most recent publicly available forecast, and those are those ones from May that were put out in July. So no, I don't have any updated forecasts from then. There's quite a big difference, Jack, though, isn't there, between $2 billion and $20 or $30 billion. And it does strike me that at the moment it seems that people can just make a claim with any old thing attached to it, and then I have to respond to that. Happy to respond to say that, you know, those figures in May are the ones we've got. Now, the final year's accounts will be put forward in the PREFU in September. It's about a month away from now, and everybody will be able to see the situation then.
Do you expect it to be worse than $2 billion at that point?
It's hard to know. I mean, obviously, the economy broadly has deteriorated since we did the budget forecast, or the Treasury did the budget forecast, and corporate tax is that area. When you look at the tax take that we're getting in terms of personal tax, that's kept up about where it was meant to be. GST, about where it's meant to be. So it's quite a specific area, and we'll have to see where that lands.
Yeah, but what are you expecting at the moment?
Well, clearly it's still a very difficult time for businesses and households, and so we'll
monitor. It sounds like you're expecting it to be greater than $2 billion.
Pre-food. I'm genuinely not making that prediction. I know it's a very difficult time. I mean, one thing I can say for sure is what we have done in terms of our spending, we're actually tracking under where it was forecast. This is about the revenue forecast that Treasury make, and obviously they get updated at PREFU.
I'm going to get to your spending in a moment. Has Treasury expressed concerns about the pace of debt accumulation?
No.
Not at all?
No.
You met with public service bosses twice in the last week and urged
them? No, I didn't.
Twice in the last 2 weeks?
No.
How many times have you met with public service? Okay. You met with public service bosses once in the last week. Did you give those bosses a specific savings target?
We, in the budget in May, established what's called the Fiscal Sustainability and Effectiveness Program. We announced that in the budget. It's there in black and white. And we said then that we would have an ongoing program to drive efficiencies and to find savings within the budget, because we've got to get ourselves back to a more sustainable fiscal position after all of the money that we put in COVID. We just have been discussing with the public service that for some time, and that meeting was about how the next stages of that go forward. This is effectively a budget-like process, and it's subject to all of that confidentiality, and when things are finalised, we'll be in a position to talk
about. Did you
give
them a specific savings target?
We discussed the program, which includes where we make savings, where we make efficiencies. We're still working that through.
Did you give them a specific savings target? That's a straight question that deserves a straight answer.
It's part of a budget process, Jack, and we are definitely working with public service bosses to make sure that we drive the savings and efficiencies that I think New Zealanders would expect us to do. This is not a bad thing, Jack. This is a good thing. This is the fact that as the government, we're saying we know times are tough out there for New Zealanders. We know we've got targets that we need to meet, and we're working with the public service on how to do that. I set two fiscal rules in 2022. One was to keep net debt below 30% of GDP. The other was to get ourselves to an Obergale surplus across the four-year forecast period. I think it's a good thing that I'm working with the public service to achieve that.
Then give us the transparency around it.
Because it's not finished yet, Jack, so there's nothing to give you.
So all I'm asking is, have you given them a specific target? I'm not even asking for the specific target. Have you given those
We're working through with public service agencies what we expect of them.
Further hard choices may be required as we navigate a pathway through this deteriorating global environment. Those are your words this week. What are those further hard choices?
Well, that's exactly the processes that we're working through. When we did the budget in May, we had $4 billion worth of savings. That represented a series of hard choices. We now have to look again at what we're doing to reach the targets and the goals that we've set ourselves. So that means ministers and agencies and departments looking at their programs, seeing if there are things that they can deliver more efficiently, seeing if they can prioritise or sequence things. All of those are hard choices. All of those are things that people want to do because we think they're good projects to do. We think the people who are delivering them are important and doing important work. There's one thing I will say for sure though, Jack, is our priority as we come to this election is the delivery of good, strong public services that the frontline services people need and deserve in health and in education, housing and social development. That's what we're prioritising. And I think this is a message for all parties in this election. It's not going to be possible to make big promises. We're already in a difficult situation for many New Zealanders. We're trying to support them through. Globally, the economy is starting to deteriorate further. The IMF told us about China the other day. We have to take note of that. And so, for me, I'll prioritise getting those services out there to New Zealanders before I would, for example, tax cuts.
There will be questions for other parties heading into the election, I'm sure. As Finance Minister, you talk often about fiscal discipline, but let's consider your record. Heading into the 2020 election, you published a fiscal plan with $7.8 billion in new spending over this term. Your actual new spending in your budgets has roughly doubled that, $14.5 billion, $14,500 million in total new spending under Labor this term, record operating allowances in your budgets. What responsibility do you take for the deteriorating fiscal position?
As I said before in my answer to you, the situation we're dealing with now is not about our spending. It's about the forecast of revenue that Treasury said was coming in. Since we made that plan in 2020...
Hang on, you asked the question.
No,
but I mean when you're spending, that requires borrowing, right? Borrowing costs in the last year, more than $3 billion alone?
Yeah, but they are, as a percentage of GDP...
$3,000 million?
As a percentage of GDP, about 1.8%. But you asked me a question about that fiscal plan in 2020 and what happened since. Delta outbreak, Omicron outbreak, Cyclone Gabriel, supply chain issues out of COVID. We've had to deal with all of those things, and I'm proud that we supported New Zealanders. Secondly, look at the macroeconomic outcomes. That's what the allowances and all of that are about, driving us towards that. We still have among the lowest debt in the developed world. We have unemployment at record low levels. We've got an economy that's 6% bigger than it was before COVID. So, for sure, we've had to invest to support New Zealanders, and we have a plan to bring our spending back down to more sustainable levels. But if people are saying we shouldn't have done that, that we should have stuck to the letter of that plan despite all of those events
it's
that
the
occurred,
quality of the
that
spend.
Would have caused a lot of heartache for New Zealanders.
It's the quality of the spend that's contended, though.
Well, yep, sure. 77,000 kids lifted out of poverty, 12,000 new state houses, 30,000, 60,000 actually more apprentices. They are good outcomes.
We have some massive expenses down the line. Climate change, a significant increase in defence and security spending, a $200 billion infrastructure deficit. In 5 years, more than 1 million New Zealanders will be over the age of 65. I think there's about $40 billion wriggle room available before you hit that self-imposed debt limit that you referenced. How will it be possible to fund those things in the future without cutting public services, massively increasing revenue, or lifting the debt limit?
Well, these are the challenges that we have to face. A big part of that is the way in which we sustainably grow the economy. That's why we have an economic plan that is about growing higher wage jobs, about, you know, finding the way through the climate change challenge and finding those opportunities that will give us good, sustainable economic growth. So that's part of the picture. Another part of the picture is making sure that we're disciplined in what we do now, that we find efficiencies. And you're right, the balance sheet's there. Good example of that is what we've done with infrastructure. In this budget in May, in 2023, we put in the National Resilience Plan. That's actually using that balance sheet to try and address some of those infrastructure needs. So it will be difficult, it will be challenging, and over the next couple of decades there will be questions that governments have to answer about how we sequence out that work, but I think we've made a good start in it.
Did you support David Parker's decision to step down as Revenue Minister?
It's not a matter for me, that's a matter between David and the Prime Minister.
You're the finance minister. You work hand in glove with him.
And I worked well with David, and I enjoyed doing that. He made his decision, the Prime Minister accepted that decision, and we just get on with it.
Why is removing GST on food a boondoggle?
Look, I've made those comments around that in the past, and you can look around the world and see some issues where those sorts of schemes have been put in place. Equally, you can see that many countries in the world have those schemes. And so, you know, boondoggles can be worked through. Jack, you know that once upon a time someone called the Sydney Opera House a boondoggle, and I think everyone likes it now.
So how would you work through a theoretical boondoggle?
You work through and you find out ways of doing things and implementing things that address the issues that people are concerned about.
So for GST on, say, I don't know, food, How would you go about working through a boondoggle for GST?
Well, that's something we can discuss another day.
What is to stop supermarkets, theoretically, from holding on to some of those GST savings if GST were to be removed.
And obviously we're in a hypothetical discussion here, Jack. But, you know, one of the things I'm really pleased about is the work we've done in terms of following through on the Commerce Commission's inquiry into supermarkets, and that includes, for example, bringing in a commissioner who we can actually work through for some of these issues, using some of the new tools that are going to be put in place, like the code of conduct that supermarkets will be under. So theoretically, there are more tools available now for people to be able to look at an issue like that if it were to happen.
Even though fruit and vegetables are obviously affected by seasonal pricing, so they don't have stable prices at the best of times.
That's a fact.
And so you're confident that, say, someone overseeing the supermarket sector could make sure that the supermarkets...
I mean, as I say, this is
those...
a theoretical conversation, but all I would say is in other jurisdictions around the world, people have found their way through the issues that arise.
In other jurisdictions around the world, have changes to sales tax when it comes to fresh fruit and vegetables disproportionately benefited higher income people?
Again, you know, there are a lot of different studies about these things. There are a lot of different ways that different policies can be implemented. If it comes to pass, we can have those discussions.
Yeah, but internationally, what's been your experience?
Well, I haven't done it internationally.
Well, obviously, you've kept an idea
on
the
tax. What I would say is that internationally, it's obviously been proven to be possible, hasn't it?
It's been proven to be popular.
Possible.
What's proved possible?
The ability to be able to have differentiation in terms of the equivalence of GST.
But who's benefited, higher income or lower income people?
I haven't done enough work to look at that.
Why were you allowed to research a wealth tax and a capital gains tax as part of a tax switch, only to have that proposal scrapped by the Prime Minister?
I think at every budget, in the history of budgets, ideas get floated. I think it was about 2013, Bill English and Michael Woodhouse did a whole lot of work around stamp duty, 6 or 7 months worth of work, and it didn't come to fruition. That's the nature of the work we did. We started that piece of work off under Jacinda Ardern's leadership. Chris Hipkins was prepared to, you know, let us complete that piece of work, and then Cabinet came to a decision not to go ahead with it. It's actually not that unusual to have an idea explored through a budget process that doesn't come to fruition.
I mean, like looking at a CGT or even a wealth tax isn't an idea that needs a great deal of exploration. So what new information can...
I'm not sure that's true, Jack. These are pretty big and fundamental changes to our tax system.
So what new pieces of information came through in that work that led Cabinet to believe now was not the right time to introduce those changes?
Oh, I think what Cabinet felt was that we were in a very uncertain and volatile time. You know, we've mentioned a little bit before about the international situation that we're facing coming off the back of COVID. And I think Cabinet's belief was that now is a time for stability. We certainly, you know, very much all agree that now is not the time for unfunded tax cuts. What was being looked at here was a tax switch, a fiscally neutral tax switch. What I see from the National Party at the moment is unfunded tax cuts, and there's certainly no room for those.
We simply didn't have the mandate. That was a line from the Prime Minister. No mandate? Do you agree with that?
Well, of course.
According to a News Hub poll in May, 53.1% of New Zealanders support a wealth tax versus 34.7% who don't.
Well, with great respect to News Hub polls, they're not the things that create mandates.
What about majority governments?
Well, majority governments campaign, don't they, on particular policy programs?
Well, apparently
we'd
not.
We'd be having a different...
Apparently not.
We'd be having a very different conversation had we gone and implemented that right now, and you'd be telling me we hadn't promised it. Having said all of that, obviously, you know, Cabinet's made its decision, and I'm focused on making sure that we get ourselves back
How
into government
hard
to
did
deliver
you
our
find?
Program. Oh, I don't discuss what happens inside the Cabinet room. We did a lot of work on the proposal.
I'm not asking about anyone else's position, but you as Finance Minister, someone who came to Parliament with very principled position when it comes to tax policy and inequality and the ways in which you might address that in New Zealand. Principled positions on fairness, how hard did you fight?
I fight hard for everything that I believe in, but the thing I fight the hardest for is to make sure that we're here to deliver to New Zealanders a fairer and more equal society. You know, just in this budget, we had the trustee rate go to, you know, up to 39 cents to fill a gap there. We're building those state houses, we're lifting kids out of poverty, We're investing in our health and education systems. They're the things that mean a lot to me, Jack, and I'll always fight hard for those.
Is it more important to win elections or to stick to your principles?
It's important to be able to deliver to people on the basis of our principles.
Is it more important to win elections?
It's not a dichotomous question, Jack.
You don't believe so?
I believe that you can stick to your principles and be able to deliver. Those two things go together. I believe the things we've delivered over the last 6 years for New Zealand are wholly in line with the principles of the Labor Party. Like I said before, I've been around for a long time, Jack. policies sometimes you get through and sometimes you don't. Every minister's experienced that. I believe in what we are doing here and I believe in the good we can do for New Zealand in the future.
Your governments have ignored the major recommendations of your tax working group. There is no comprehensive capital gains tax, no wealth tax, your income insurance policy has been scrapped. You repeatedly reintroduced the petrol tax cut in the face of what your government said is a climate crisis. Are those the decisions of a Labor government that is putting principle ahead of polling?
I'll tell you what this Labor government has been able to do. It's been able to consistently lift the incomes of the lowest income New Zealanders. We've made sure that we've lifted family tax credits. We've made sure that we've lifted the minimum wage on a consistent basis.
That wasn't my question.
But what I'm saying to you is those things are important and principled decisions. We have, as we all governments have to do, have to take decisions to be able to keep moving forward. I'm part of a cabinet. I'm part of collective responsibility. What I look at is the greater good that we have achieved, and I'm very proud of it.
Are you committed to another full term in Parliament, regardless of the result in October?
I'm running to be re-elected as the Minister of Finance. That is my goal, and that's the only thing I've got in my head at the moment.
If Labor finds itself out of government in October, will you consider your
future? Purely hypothetical. I'll consider that if that comes to pass, but my only consideration right now is being part of being re-elected in the Chris Hipkins-led government.